Before I say anything else, I actually want to commend the people who brought this meeting together. I give a lot of talks all over the place, and many of the events that I attend portray themselves as being global, international, a world conference. This, far and away, has been the most diverse, most truly global event I've been to, with over 150 countries on the absolutely a great job. So I'm just very happy to be here. So, there's been this looming presence throughout this event. The end of the world. And it's important to recognize that when we talk about the end of the world, we're not just talking about the destruction of the planet Earth. We're also talking about the end of the world for people. You know, individuals. When a village is hit by a flood, when an earthquake takes down a city, this is the end of the world for the folks who live here. The end of the world is a recurring theme throughout all of the issues we talk about. And we're talking about collapse. We're talking about fear, disasters, chaos. And we know what that looks like. It looks like flooding in Venice. And I have to say that as I was coming in, I was flying in, I was sitting on the wrong side of the plane, so I didn't actually get to see a wonderful aerial view of Venice. I got to see this. This is a coal-fired power plant. Now, those of you who pay even the slightest amount of attention to climate change know that coal is one of the biggest problems that we're facing around carbon emissions. And given that Venice has been suffering increased flooding, was likely to be one of the first high-profile victims of climate disruption, it's kind of ironic and painful to think that Venice is powering itself with something that is ultimately destroying. We're also talking about governments and surveillance and violence and that kind of looming presence of observation where you know that you're being watched. These are another form of catastrophe, another form of an end of the world. Economic disruption, the collapse of manufacturing, the collapse of industry, the shift towards automation, where people are looking ahead at possibly losing not just their current job, but losing the potential for any job going forward as our capacity to build devices that take over more and more positions happens faster and faster and faster. It happens faster than our ability to create new professions. We basically end up creating jobs that we can create algorithms and robotic systems that can take over those jobs immediately. That picture, by the way, it's based on a famous photo from the United States in the Great Depression in the 1930s, where somebody said jobless men keep going, but decided to update it for the 21st century. Or pandemic. This is a graphic of the Zika virus, which is in all the press these days, but it's not the only thing that we're worried about. I mean, avian flu is there on the horizon, or they're sort of still sort of skulking around. We know that we are at risk. We know that there are these dangers, these potential calamities that swirl at our feet or come from above. And this one would in fact be a planet ender. Fortunately, we have pretty good knowledge that nothing like that is coming anytime soon, unless it's a crisis. Now, when we think about being hit by an asteroid, we think about what paleoscientists call the KT event, the border between the Cretaceous and the Tertiary, the end of the age of dinosaurs. We think about, this was a brachiosaurus skeleton at the Berlin Museum of Natural History. An allosaurus arm that I took a picture of at the Dinosaur National Monument in Utah. A T-Rex skeleton in the Berkeley Biosciences building. The dinosaurs wiped out 65 million years ago. Except that's not quite what happened. Also, the Berlin Natural History Museum is this. Archaeopteryx, probably the most important fossil find ever, because it demonstrated the link between dinosaurs and birds. In a very real way, birds are dinosaurs. So when the Chicxulub Club asteroid hit 65 million years ago, it didn't drive the dinosaurs out of existence, it forced them to change. It was a catalyst, a trigger for evolutionary change, for radical adaptation. Dinosaurs survived. Dinosaurs were remarkably successful. They went from being these lumbering giant beasts to flying creatures that literally fill the planet, fill niches that no one else, you know, no other species can get to. Maybe it's time to reevaluate our understanding of disaster, of mayhem. So it's time to think about resilience, adaptation, creativity, knowledge. Yeah, these are the themes that we've been talking about this week. Resilience in particular, but all three of these are linked. All three of these are connected to each other. Resilience, this is my favorite picture of resilience. This is from my grandfather's time in World War II. He was with the 82nd Field Hospital. And this was in Belgium in 1945. Passing over a bridge. Local women doing laundry in a bomb held railway. And think about that. Experiencing the horrors of what was at that time the biggest and most violent war we've ever had on this planet. And taking care of the prosaic day-to-day needs, the normalization of chaos, and the adaptation to chaos, resilience by simply continuing to live a normal life as best you can. Resilience through living. You know, we have some modern variations on what resilience can be. This is the Svalbard seed vault, where we're storing, you know, as many different varieties of core plant life that we can, so that if there is some kind of massive disaster, we have something we can draw from to replenish life, which has now been drawn from the first time. A group of researchers in Syria, all of their specimens from the lab that they were working with, including some essentially unique species, destroyed in the current civil war, except for the backups in salt. Resilience can look like this kind of normalization of transformation. So this is, in case it's really not entirely clear, this is an electric car charging unit. And it's in a McDonald's parking lot, 2 blocks from my house. I don't live in the midst of a big, you know, I don't live in Palo Alto, I don't live in a big rich city, I live in the suburbs. And this, at a McDonald's, this has become the transformation of our economy, the transformation of our district, infrastructure, all this is becoming normal. And at the same time, it can be, you know, spectacular. It can be amazing to see, you know, a solar tower system that uses mirrors to reflect literally megawatts of solar, of light, concentrating it to generate electricity. It can be the adaptation of natural processes to try to alleviate the problems we're facing. These are different mechanisms of doing carbon dioxide removal from the atmosphere. Different ways to try to draw down the biochemistry or the atmospheric chemistry that is giving us potentially disastrous outcomes. Now, this isn't fast, but it's a relentless process. Sometimes it's embodying the imagination, trying to create an idea of what the next generation of our experience could be like. This is a design for what they're calling ancient caverns, but essentially it's a new model for cities, primarily being researched or being developed in China. The idea of integrating and the iterating farms and wildlife in the same kinds of facilities that you have in which you have people living. It's vertical farms alongside and integrates in vertical dwellings. Sometimes it's in taking the technologies that have been used against us and using them to empower ourselves. This is a photo I took in Berkeley last year of people watching and watching. Using these tools that nearly every one of us carries, nearly everyone, and certainly in this room, and in much of the world, has these kind of devices that give you the ability to keep track of what's happening around you, to observe and report, and not just do so at the behest of public safety officials, or the behest of the police, but and to do so in a way that empowers citizens. We're seeing this as an engine of very, very rough transformation of the United States around policing. People, you know, the authorities who have for decades, longer, been able to get away with abuse, no longer can do so because their actions are being documented. And we're seeing this happen around the world. The Witness organization has for decades been making available video cameras to allow people in authoritarian and totalitarian countries to record those abuses. And the advent of smartphones, the advent of this kind of technology allowed that idea to flourish. No longer did they have to try to smuggle the videotape out. They just had to send an encrypted packet of data. Or it's using the technologies to keep track on what we do. To have understand the provenance, the pathway of the foods and the products that we consume that are parts of our lives. Using it for citizen science, or to monitor our planet, monitor ourselves. All of these technologies, not as a way of exerting control, but as a way of developing knowledge. Or even changing how you see the world. This was a mock-up that I did for a project thinking about what would it be like as we start using different kinds of technology, smart glasses, or even contact lenses, if you could block out every ad around you. What would it like? This was a picture I took in Times Square that I went through and then blocked out every branding or marketing image. Think about a world where you never have to see an advertisement, a billboard, ever again. And these kinds of tools are not within the control of top-down authorities. It's actually a recurring point of frustration for a lot of groups. How come you can use an ad blocker on your web browser? How come you can skip commercials with your DVR? These tools that have become so prosaic for many of us can have almost revolutionary impacts on our relationship with institutions of power. 3D printers. They've gone from being really exotic to being something that a lot of people know about and sort of expecting to be a big deal. They're a big deal. As the price is driven down, as the precision gets improved, I actually just saw a report yesterday of a company developing printers, 3D printers that can embed electronics within the objects that they print. Or we now have 3D printers, people using them to print out prosthetics, to print out body parts. There are people walking around today in this world with 3D printed knees, even a couple different types of internal organs. We can 3D print more and more of our bodies. In China, they're trying out the process of 3D printing houses. Now, these are not going to win awards from Architecture Digest or anything like that. They probably aren't even terribly energy efficient. But they were building a neighborhood over the course of a day with essentially a big 3D printer. And all of this is basically allowing us to have greater and greater control over, or greater and greater access to the mechanisms of manufacturing, And so you may see a factory wiped out, but in turn, you're also seeing the emergence of this kind of democratized production, distributed production, getting even easier. This is actually something that there's a toy company called Mattel. They are most famous for Barbie. But this is their thing maker that is coming out in a few months for the price of, essentially the price of a PlayStation or Xbox. So in the hyper-developed world, something a lot of homes will have access to. A 3D printer aimed at kids with software to let them develop things and print them out. Print out their own toys, print out their own stuff. And you think about where that might be going, that kind of transformation of the economy, moving away from these conventional 18th, 19th century models of manufacturing and distribution to something that's completely, radically different. And not just in the West, but globally, because the one recurring aspect of these tools is just how low cost they can be. And the price keeps going, getting lower and lower and lower. When I first started looking at 3D printers, this was about 2001. They were running like $25,000, $30,000, $50,000. To think about the fact that you'd be able to buy a relatively good one for about $300 is kind of remarkable. Then the tools of manufacturers, of altering, of changing not just the physical world, but our genetic world. Being able to deal with pandemics not simply by trying, decreasing the effect of drugs, antibiotics, and things like, but actually think about what can we do to go in and change the DNA of pathogens, change our own DNA. And just like 3D printing, other kinds of distributed manufacturing is democratizing that process, we're also seeing the democratization of the spread, the global spread of the ability to look at DNA, to look at biology as itself, something that we can manipulate, something that we can explore, something that will give us the ability to learn more and more about ourselves and about our world. Even to do things like make meat. This is a burger that is a 100% beef muscle burger that required no animal to die, had essentially a zero carbon footprint, because it's all the muscle tissue is all grown in a lab. And taken and stimulated to basically make the muscle bulk up and convert it into ground beef. And the people who, this was actually a tasting session done for a whole bunch of restaurant reviewers in this factory at the BBC. They said, yeah, it's a little bland, but otherwise, the taste, the texture, it was a burger. Think about that. One of the major sources of carbon emissions isn't a CO2 source, but a methane source, and that's cow. I did some work about 2007, 2008, looking at the carbon footprint of cheeseburgers. A conventional burger like this would have itself a carbon footprint of about 4.5 kilograms CO2 equivalent. Okay, well, what does that number mean? Turns out that all the burgers eaten just in the U.S. over the course of a year has the same carbon footprint as all of the sport utility vehicles and light trucks being driven to the U.S. And so you can multiply that up globally and realize that all of that can go away. All of that can disappear. And something that's within our power. And you can get into some exotic stuff. This was an experiment done about a year and a half ago. Transferring a thought over the internet from France to India. First in France was in a magnetic resonance imaging system. Able to read, the system was able to read changes in that person's brain as they were thinking a very specific thing, digitize that, transmit it over the net, and then have that get connected to a transcranial magnetic stimulation system in India that essentially stimulated the recipient's brain so that when the person in France thought, I've turned the light bulb on, the person in India suddenly thought they turned the light bulb on. That's very true. It's basically able to very, in a very special way, transmit a bit. Yeah, one off or on. Now think about that. The transmission of a thought. Digital telepathy. Not today, not tomorrow. Within a few decades, maybe. But even if this doesn't end up being a transformative technology in and of itself, let's think about what it means in terms of the research that we're doing, the improved understanding of how our minds work, the improved ability to communicate. And if you want to get really funky, this is a project, the Revive and Restore project, is looking at what it would take to bring back a number of recently extinct species. To bring back a passenger pigeon. To bring back a variety of animal and plant species that within the last 1,000 years have been driven extinct by human activity. To basically to correct a human mistake. That's actually what's being done. Think about what that means to know that we don't have, that extinction doesn't have to be forever. That maybe, just maybe, we can apologize to the planet and fix things. When we talk about resilience, we talk about reinvention. We talk about transparency, innovation, inspiration, and imagination. These are the mechanisms, these are the engines of resilience. These are the things that allow us to think about the world, think about an end of the world scenario, and have it be something that we can, well, I'll say look forward to, but we can look ahead at and think, okay, we can handle that. We can deal with that. This is one of my favorite pictures ever. It's Saturn, obviously. Taken by the Cassini probe a few years ago. And this picture is remarkable for a couple of reasons. Well, three reasons, really. One, it's a really outstanding computer desktop. The second is, it's an image that we literally never could have before. Because it's taken with Saturn eclipsing the sun. We're on the other side of that. We can never see that until we built this machine that can travel out there and take this image for us. But the most important part, and we can't really see it on this display, so let me zoom in. That's us. That little couple pixels across. Every person who has ever lived. Every place we've ever been. Everything we've ever made except for a small handful of machines that are just now skirting the edges of interstellar space. Everything that we are. It's a couple pixels across. And I love this picture because it demonstrates both the fragility and the brilliance of human civilization. And it's a tension between the fragility and the brilliance that inspires us. It's that tension that drives us forward because we know just how fragile we are. Just how easily we end up in the end of the world scenario. But we also know just how much we are driven by the ability to learn and to create. Imagine. Those of us who are in the futurating world, and I don't just mean people, you know, I may be the only person in the room who describes myself as a futurist, but a lot of us here do this kind of foresight work, whether we're involved in insurance or strategic planning. You've got to look ahead and think about the implications. And for a lot of us, Cassandra, from ancient Greek myth, is our, I don't say our idol, but we feel a lot of sympathy for her. She was the person cursed to be able to see the future but have no one believe her. And those of us who do this futuring work, all of us have experienced that point of knowing that this is going to be a problem, this is something we need to pay attention to, and nobody will listen. Cassandra is me, it feels like sometimes. But I've recently come to change my mind about that. Thinking more Pandora, another character from ancient Greek myth, famously opened up the container that trapped all of the miseries of the world, all of the disasters, and anger, pain, despair, all of these things have been closed up, and she revealed them to the world. And I know that as a futurist, I'm not responsible for all the world's struggles. But it kind of feels like I'm the one out there trying to ring that bell and say, hey, everybody, look, there are problems. And it gets to me. But then, you remember that the miseries of the world, the dilemmas and disasters and pain, weren't the only things in that container.